Next, we'll talk about assessment. There are some potential cultural specific barriers to assessment in the South Asian population. One that I alluded to in the earlier segment is that there's a common belief that dementia symptoms are part of normal aging. There may even be some stigma related to reporting dementia symptoms, thinking that it may be disrespectful to your elderly grandparent or parent to report their dementia symptoms. Another potential barrier is that spoken versions of many Indian languages lack a term for dementia, so it may be hard to translate. So what do we do? There are some instruments for cognitive assessment that are validated in South Asian languages. For example, the Hindi mental state exam developed by Ganguly and colleagues is one instrument. Another is the Gujarati mental state exam by Lindsay and colleagues. Another way to go is to use low literacy instruments in those patient populations that might need it. These are instruments in English, but use a lot of pictures as opposed to words, so they're easy to use across different cultural groups. One is the Montreal Cognitive Assessment, or commonly known as the MoCA, or the CASI, the Cognitive Assessment Screening Instrument. Next, I'll show you some brief tools that are really useful in assessment: the MiniCog and the Patient Health Questionnaire 2. The MiniCog is a really useful screening tool for cognitive impairment. It's often used with well-functioning older adults who are living in the community to assess to see if there are cognitive impairment problems present that require further evaluation. It includes a very brief test, a 3-item recall, and then a clock draw. It really takes less than 3 minutes to administer, so it's really quick. And if you're a provider, a primary care physician, or another healthcare practitioner in the community, it's really kind of easy to insert this into your daily routine. It really helps to sort out those who have significant cognitive problems from those who are having good or normal cognition. It is shown to be effective for different cultural and linguistic groups and also educationally diverse older adults. What is the 3-item registration and recall? So what you do is you instruct your patient to listen carefully and repeat the following 3 words using a 1-second pause between each, like this: apple, watch, penny. Then you ask them to do a clock drawing task. You ask the person to draw a circle like this. Then you ask them to draw the hours of the clock inside that circle like this. Lastly, you ask them to put the hands at 45 minutes past 10 o'clock. After drawing the clock, what do you do next? You ask the person to repeat the 3 words that you used at the first part of the test: apple, watch, penny. What do you do if they don't remember the words or they only recall one of the words? You're not supposed to prompt them or help them remember. You just note down what they said, whether they were able to recall the words or not. And this is how the scoring will work for the MiniCog. A person who gets all 3-item recall wrong is significantly cognitively impaired. Those who get 1 to 2 right, or those who get 3 right. So those who get 3 right answers are not cognitively impaired. If they get 1 to 2 right and have an abnormal clock drawing, they would be among the group who would get referred for further workup. If they have 1 to 2 item recall incorrect and their clock drawing task is normal, then we would consider them not cognitively impaired, but would watch and wait and refer them for a secondary evaluation in a few months' time. Next, we'll move to screening for depression. Why is this important? Well, we know that cognitive impairment and depression sort of are linked. They kind of go together. So it's really important if you're going to assess for one that you assess for the other at the same time. Well, it's really nice if you could do this rather quickly, particularly if you're a primary care physician working in the community. Here's one instrument that we could use. It's the Patient Health Questionnaire 2. It's a screen or a first step approach, just like the mini-cog. And if they score positively, then you can follow up with an evaluation with the full instrument, the PHQ-9. Here's the PHQ-2. It's really just 2 items. Over the past 2 weeks, how often have you felt bothered by any one of the following problems? The first is little interest or pleasure in doing things. And the patient can respond, not at all, have been bothered several days, more than half the days, or nearly every day, with the specific scores. The second item is, over the past 2 weeks, how often have you been bothered by feeling down, depressed, or hopeless? And then the patient can respond on this scale from 0 to 3. So basically, if the patient scores a 3 or more, they should be then referred for further evaluation. The Patient Health Questionnaire, the PHQ-9, has been translated into several South Asian languages. The first 2 items, PHQ-1 and 2, are part of the brief screen. The languages that might be relevant for your South Asian populations are English for India, Hindi, Urdu, Kannada, Malayalam, Gujarati, Punjabi, Marathi, Uriya, Tamil, or Telugu. If you have a patient that is monolingual in any of these languages, you could use the first 2 items for a brief screen for depression. So in summary, if you're out there in the community practicing and seeing South Asian patients and you insert these screens into your routine for older patients, the patients may ask, what can you do? What can they do to keep their brains healthy? So what I thought we could do is look at what's going on now and a culture-specific action plan to really help them preserve their brain health. So right now, when we look at how South Asians are doing, they have low reported physical activity in more than half of the South Asians. Many of them have an increased westernization of their diet and high BMIs. Some have mobility restriction and osteoarthritis is quite high, up to 4 times the rates that are in the West. And often reported is social isolation in new immigrants who come to this country, particularly in that adult followers group. Lastly, they might be incorporating curcumin in their diet or turmeric. Okay, well, what's the flip side? What are some things that they can do to keep their brains healthy? Well, a cultural specific action plan could be to incorporate physical activity, including walking. In some studies in the UK, they noticed that with South Asian patients in particular, that physical activity was increased, their uptake was increased when a social component was involved. That goes with the culture. Next, we see that some South Asians have a more traditional diet. Others have a more Western diet. Both have inherent risks. So it's important to work out, you know, what kind of diet is best for that particular patient. But maybe a common goal could be to lower their BMI. That is really important, regardless of the type of diet that they're eating. For mobility restriction, it's really important to incorporate flexibility and possibly yoga exercises into the routine to increase flexibility. In terms of social isolation, it's really important to maintain active social networks, particularly if there's a big change in social networks between their old networks in the home country and their new networks in the U.S. Lastly, there are many news reports about curcumin or turmeric as being a potential cure for Alzheimer's disease. But what the data really show is that there are 7 trials that have been conducted to date, and there are no published results, so we really don't know. It doesn't seem that the intake of turmeric would do any harm, though. So if your patients are taking turmeric, I think the important thing to say is that it can't do any harm, but we don't know if it has any cognitive benefits.